All praises, man. So as y'all know, unless you've just been stuck under a rock for the last 24 to 48 hours,
man.
A lot of things have transpired. Shootings, explosions, riots, civil unrest, man.
It's been
civil unrest, you know. So y'all go to IUIC Dallas on Faith on YouTube and check out the music video that we just posted today. Days of Civil Unrest featuring Officers Rubavel and Soldier Obadiah.
Yeah, they posted it right now. They saw them and they just watched y'all video.
There you go.
Y'all pray for me. Y'all go check it out, man. So I know y'all brothers want to go in. So kind of give me your thoughts, Officers Rubavel, on because, you know, we were there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we was there front line, not front line as in gunfire, but front line as in we heard the bullets and stuff like that. So what was kind of your thought? What was going on in your head?
I mean, I'm still having thoughts. I just put up a message to the brothers letting them know my car got shot up. I mean, that's part of the residual effect of what happened. My main thought at the time in the midst of the chaos was everything that's going on, the only thing that's stable right now is Israel. We were the only ones that had some structure and some order amongst all the chaos. And that's how it's supposed to be, because when you read Ezekiel 37 chapter, he said he's going to raise up an army, and the army is structured. I'm looking out to our people as we're speaking to them. I see a misguided nation. They had a fake pastor lead the way in the beginning. I missed, but I heard the brothers talk about them. They had a Cesar Borgia walking down the street leading the people with a cross on his shoulder. And like I said, I see a misguided nation. That's the first thought that comes to my mind. I'm not even thinking about necessarily the shooting. I'm thinking about everything else that's involved around the shooting. The shooting wouldn't happen if we didn't have a bunch of misguided people out there following Cesar Borgia around. Because then the cops wouldn't have to be in there to guide them and assist them and so forth. So that's the first thing that came to my mind. A lot came to my mind, but I let the other brothers expound on what they thought.
I don't really have a lot to say. He did a good job explaining it. It brought me back to my military days, because I had to go through certain scenarios. I was on a ship, so the mindset that I had being in the military to the mindset that I had being in this troop is totally different. Being in the line of fire when you're in the military, it's chaos, you're nervous, you're afraid. But being in the troop, there's no fear, because you know the reason why this is happening. And you on the right side of the team. So your fear, your thought, and your mindset is totally different from being in the world, which we saw how our people are. They march, they say they believe in Jesus, they say they believe in God, but there's chaos and there's fear. So the real Christ is not there. Based on us walking down the street, mm-hmm. us seeing what's going on, there's no fear.
Right.
We understand. So that's it.
I'm going to deal with just a certain portion of it because, again, we talked about the protest, and you look across the world, New York, Louisiana, all these different places, you see people trying to link up with all the nations to help save black lives, as they call it, but we call it the Israelites, right? Because it's more than just so-called black people. So what I'll touch on is, if we want to have any type of liberation, if we want to have any type of freedom and justice and so forth, all the things that you see on the signs, the picket signs and everything else, guess what we're going to have to do? We have to do it ourselves.
Right.
They have examples of it here in America. If you go to New York, the Jewish community got their own police department and so forth. They police themselves. But yet, you look in our community, we depend on the other nations and the government and so forth to police us. Instead of following God's laws, policing ourselves, we look to them. Let's start in Lamentations first.
This is the book of Lamentations, chapter 4, verse 17. As for us, our eyes as yet fail for our own vain help. In our watching, we have watched for a nation that could not save us.
Read that again.
As for us, our eyes as yet fail for our vain help.
As for us, the Israelites, blacks, Hispanics, Native Americans across the world, South Central America, the islands, scattered abroad throughout the four corners of the earth. It says, our eyes have failed. Read it again.
As for us, our eyes as yet fail mm-hmm. for our vain help.
Our vain help. When you march and you asking for help from people who don't care about you, how much help do you think you're going to get? Little to none. Little to none. But yet, you do have brothers who know who we are, hence the brothers you're looking at right now on Periscope, the brothers that are spread out throughout the four corners of the earth teaching this truth. You have brothers who understand who we are and what the mission is. But yet, our people look to the other nations for help. Go ahead.
In our watching, we have watched for a nation that could not save us.
Primarily, that nation for us being America. We look for that nation to save us. Well, guess what? America brings you death. America brings you death. So we want justice in our neighborhoods, right? Brothers are selling drugs to each other, and then when another brother gets shot by a cop and so forth, we want to scream for justice. Well, what about the justice you can provide by not committing sin and iniquity in your own community, by going back to what God's laws tell you to do and not suffer sin upon your brother? That's the very first step to making sure that everything's going to be okay within your own community. You don't have to look to the other nations, to the government, or anybody else for help when you have the Bible who gives it gives you the instructions on what to do. Get that in Proverbs right quick, 6:23. We have the instructions right here in front of us. We don't have to look to any other nation, a government, a people, or whatever you want to call it, for any type of salvation, because it's already written in the Bible how we will be saved. Go ahead.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 6 and verse 23. Mm-hmm. For the commandment is a lamp, mm-hmm. and the law is light.
So you have your lamp and you have your light. What does that do for you? Go ahead.
And reproofs of instruction are the way of life.
It shows you your path. So this is the way of life. This is the way that you're supposed to navigate through our life, through the law, statutes, and commandments. So if we have that, guess what? We don't have to march. Because if we have our own communities like we did back in the 1920s, if we have our own communities like we did back in the 1800s, which we'll bring out proof of that, guess what? The other nations looked to us for help, and they did that. They did that before. Why? Because we liberated ourselves, and that's what we have to do today. But you can't do it with a gun. The brother tried to gun down. Well, he gunned down police officers and civilians, right? Are we free? No. We're still here right now talking about what happened in our captivity. So in order to free yourself, guess what you have to do? You have to have an understanding of God's laws first and foremost, and then quit depending on the other nations. Let's go back to Lamentations.
The book of Lamentations, chapter 4, verse 17. Mm-hmm. As for us, our eyes as yet fail for our vain help. In our watching, we have watched for a nation that could not save us.
They can't save us. Only person that's going to bring us out of this captivity is Christ. And that's after we unite and we come back together, as it is written in the scriptures. As we repent and the one-third repents and wakes up, then we usher in the kingdom. All right, I'm going to touch on that a little bit later. Let's go to Deuteronomy 28:65. All right, we have to understand what this Bible is telling us. This is a true book. This is not a mystery book that sits up in the church and nobody has an understanding of it. We have the understanding. It's up to you to apply the scriptures so that you can get the understanding. Go ahead.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28 and verse 65. Mm-hmm. And among these nations shalt thou find no ease.
So those same nations that we're looking for help and for peace and everything else under the sun, he says what?
And among these nations shalt thou find no ease. Uh-huh. Neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest.
Neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest. Meaning what? I could be in a car with my wife. I got a busted taillight. I have a license to carry. When the police officer asks me for my ID and I try to get it, I get gunned down.
Neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest.
Or I could be buying some Skittles out of a store, and I'm walking on my way home, and I get harassed by a police officer, and I get gunned down in the middle of the street with my body left out in the sun for hours upon hours upon hours. Neither shall the sole of thy feet have rest. We cannot have rest here with the other nations. Our mission, our goal is to unite the Israelites so that we can have our kingdom, so that we don't have to worry about Edomite cop or any other type of crooked cop putting our brothers to death. Because guess what? It's not just the Edomites. We got our own brothers that hate us.
Right.
I was speaking with the state senator. And I won't even mention his name. You can do your research and find out who he is. At the march, I was speaking with the state senator, and I asked him, what do you do for our community? He could not answer. He had to look around, take a ponder about it. And so I kind of bailed him out. I said, well, what do you do? What does the state senator do? Just to help him out. So he started mentioning the things that he do. None of it has to do with the communities that we live in, because they don't care about a community. All they care about is the chief seat that they sit in, making sure that their boys are okay, making sure their family can go to college and so forth, making sure their pockets are laced. Right. It's not about helping us liberate ourselves so that we can have our own establishments, our own businesses, our own schools.
Right.
It's not about that.
That's John 11 chapter right
yeah,
there.
Yeah, exactly. You can read that real quick.
All right, let's get
that. I ain't gonna forget the subject matter.
Right. Let's.
They cannot save us.
No, you good. Let's get the book of John chapter 11. Let's see where we're gonna start. Verse 48. So this goes into what the officer was talking about. How they don't care about us. They're more worried about the seat that they sit in.
Right. This is John 11, chapter 48, verse. If we let him thus alone, all men will believe on him.
Uh-huh.
And the Romans shall come and take away both our place and nation.
Read that again.
If we leave him thus alone, all men will believe on him.
So they were talking about Christ. If we leave Christ alone, the people will start to believe on him. The same thing when we're out there passing out the flyers, speaking to the people, that worries them. That concerns them. Because it's no longer about them putting money in their pockets. It's no longer about their status. It's about Christ, which is what it should be about. Read on.
And the Romans shall come and take away both our place and nation.
And America will take away their place and everything that they have. They don't want that. Go ahead, Austin.
So again, I was talking to this guy trying to figure out what he does for our community. How come we can't establish certain businesses in our community? How come we don't have our own police department? How come we don't have our own schools? How come we don't have our own? And I'm asking him to see what he does. Sitting in the state senate seat, you should be able to have some power to do something. You came out to show face and to get love for your seat, for your office and so forth. So when voting time comes around, you get the votes. Voting doesn't change anything, obviously, because whoever voted you in the office, and nothing's changed. So what do we have to do? We got to follow God's laws. And his laws tell us what to do. But it tells us this within the statutes, that we would never have rest. So my son can't even go to the store or drive in a car with a busted tail light. My daughter can't go to a local swimming pool. All these different things that happened in the past year. Our people cannot have peace. Why? Because we rely on the other nations. God said, I'm sending you to these other nations to be proven, to see if you will keep my commandments in the midst of them. And you will not have rest as long as you're along with them. Go ahead and read it again.
This is the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, and verse 65. And among these nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest.
You're going to work day and night, dollar to dollar. At the end of the month, you don't have enough money to even, if you have a flat tire that and you got to go pay for that flat tire, and now you broke for the rest of the month. No ease. Go ahead.
But the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart.
He will give you a trembling heart. How do you know you have a trembling heart? Because when you see those red, white, and blue lights behind you, you are so afraid. If an Edomite sees those same lights, they ready to talk noise and tell them how they inconveniencing their day and so forth. Right. We trying to, you know, figure out how we're going to speak, sit upright and so forth, make sure I got everything in line, keep my hands on the wheel. It's trembling of heart. Go ahead.
And failing of eyes.
And failing of eyes. Everything that we see before us fails us. Why? Because it's not of the Lord. It's of the Lord, but it's not for us. The things that he put in place that we see in front of us right now, it's not for us to succeed and have success in their ways and their matters. He has it set up for us a certain way to succeed. And we have to, when you read Joshua 1 and 8, it tells you that. It tells you how to have success. The prosperity that they promise us, the things that they have lined up for us, it is not for us. It's to keep us in sin. Everything they do is to keep us in sin. Go ahead.
And sorrow of mind.
And sorrow of mind. So when we saw our brothers hanging from trees, we saw our women hanging from trees, gutted open, burn up, shot up. These things really happen in history. And we speak about it because it's the truth. And they hate us for it. But guess what? We're going to continue to speak the truth. These things happen so that we can look at it and see. Hold that. Read verse 46.
This is the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28. And verse 46, and they shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder.
These things are happening so that you can look at it and you start to wonder, why is this happening to our people? Well, he just told you, it's for a sign. It's to tell you who you are so that no other nation can take claim to who we are, to our heritage, to what God gave us. It's for a sign for you to know. So when you read in the Bible, it tells you that certain men will get put to death and so forth, except for the men that had a mark. Right? But these things are happening so we can know who we are. Jump back over.
This is the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, and verse 65. And among these nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest. But the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart, and failing of eyes, and sorrow of mind.
Sorrow of mind. Go ahead.
And thy life shall hang in doubt before thee.
And our lives literally hung in doubt before us. I just saw an article that a brother posted that there was a brother hanging. I forgot where it was.
Atlanta.
Piedmont. Yeah. Piedmont Park.
Piedmont Park. A brother was hanging. Our lives shall hang in doubt before us. Go ahead.
And thou shalt fear day and night.
You shall fear day and night. There is no peace. There is no peace of mind amongst our people. First and foremost, because we're being wicked and we're breaking God's laws. That's what verse 15 tells you. That's why we don't have the peace. But at the same time, he said, I'm going to deliver you to your enemies. Another reason why we would not have peace. I don't know any black man in America that 100% trust the police. Even if you are police, I know police officers that don't trust the police. Why? Because our lives are in doubt. We have no ease. The sole of our foot have no rest. Go ahead.
And shalt have none assurance of thy life.
Should have what?
And shalt have none assurance of thy life.
If I'm selling CDs outside of a store I had permission to sell in front of, guess what? I have no assurance of my life. Why? Because I might get shot in the chest 4 to 6 times. Right. When they have both of my hands. I'm not even resisting. Right? Or I could be telling the officer, I cannot breathe, but yet he continues to choke me out. I can't breathe. So what, nigga? Shut up. No assurance of life. Go ahead.
Verse 67. In the morning thou shalt say, would God it were even? And at even thou shalt say, would God it were morning?
Right, because we want the days to be over. Brothers are telling me I'm amped up and I'm coming around looking like a man on a mission. And so I am. I want the days to be, I want these days to be over. All right. Because there's no ease, there's no rest. The only time we get rest is when the kingdom comes. All right, anybody want to say anything before I move on that?
It says none, bottom of verse 66, and shall have none assurance of life. There's no assurance that you can get pulled over for a basic traffic ticket, right, and you make it home after that stop.
Mm-hmm.
You can have. There are other nations. The so-called white man, he can have a machete, and I've seen them in the video.
Yeah.
He can have a machete in his hand.
They just fucking shot him with a taser. Oh, shit. What the fuck? Holy shit. Oh my god. Whoa, look at that old bus. Get on the ground. He had a fucking machete.
Get on the ground. Get on the ground. On the ground. Get on the ground. Get on the ground. Please. Please get on the ground.
Oh shit, that's our bus. Yo, let's catch the next one. Let's catch the dude.
Threatening the police, running after the police, and he's assured to at least make it to prison.
Mm-hmm.
But a brother can be reaching for his license and not be guaranteed to even get a ticket because he's going to get shot to death.
Mm-hmm.
No assurance. That proves that this can only be talking about the Israelites, because other nations are proving to us on video that they have the assurance to at least make it home or to at least make it to prison. We don't have that assurance.
Right. Finish out 67.
Verse 67, Deuteronomy chapter 28 and verse 67. In the morning thou shalt say, would God it were even? Mm-hmm. And at even thou shalt say, would God it were morning?
Meaning we wanted it, especially out on those plantations, you wanted it to be over. Go ahead.
For the fear of thine heart wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes which thou shalt see.
Which thou shalt see. The things that we see right now, those are the things that we want to be over. We don't want our brothers gunned down, but yet we know not to go take up arms against the Edomites and so forth. Why? Because the Most High blessed them with the sword. When you read in Genesis, you have that understanding.
Right.
He blessed them with the sword, but let me show you what he blessed us with. Get Baruch 3:36 right quick. He blessed them with the sword, but you've heard many times the pen is mightier than the sword. And with the pen comes what? Things that are scribed, things that are written, books and so forth, right? Read this.
This is the book of Baruch chapter 3 and verse 36. He hath found out all the way of knowledge, and hath given it unto Jacob, his servant, and to Israel, his beloved.
So regardless of them being blessed with the sword and having domination over us physically, which I'll touch that in Deuteronomy real quick, it says he hath found out all the ways of knowledge and hath given it unto Jacob, his servant, and to Israel, his beloved. When you have all the ways of knowledge, guess what? You have everything you need. You have everything that you need. But our people don't realize that because they don't first and foremost know that they Israel. 1 Kings 8:47 tells you that we must wake up to the not bethink yourself. Wake up to who you are. Admit that you were in sin and then go change. Because once you do that, once you understand and admit that you've been in sin, now you can change the things that are wrong in your communities. When you realize that having boyfriend and girlfriends is wrong and that marriage is honorable and all, guess what we just did? STDs, gone. Right? AIDS, gone. Planned Parenthood, gone. Adultery, gone. Or should be gone. Right? These things change. So now we don't have all the residual effects and the aftermath of all the iniquities that we committed. Because we have all the ways of knowledge and we applied it. Read it one more time.
This is the book of Baruch, chapter 3 and verse 36. Mm-hmm. He had found out all the way of knowledge, mm-hmm, and had given it unto Jacob his servant.
Right.
And to Israel his beloved.
Right. So our Edomite servants, which they will be one day, they call knowledge capitus, and which eventually came the word capital, right? And so we live in a capitalist society. Capital just means knowledge of the head. That's what it means. So if they say they're the top capitalists in the world, meaning they have the top knowledge in the head, but we just read in the Bible that we have all the ways of knowledge, guess what? We have all the capital, meaning what? We can change everything we see before us. Everything can alter before us, just like in the 1920s when they did it for Black Wall Street. Everything before us is ours to have if we apply ourselves, but we have not done that. So thus, guess what? We rely on our enemies. We rely on the other nations, and the scripture just told us not to do that. When you read this book I'm going to bring out in a minute, it goes into depth about how they took a lot of our inventions and so forth. They did a lot of different things. Why? Because we've been blessed with all the ways of knowledge, and we have to apply that. But we don't even want to look at who we are, where we come from, and so forth. We don't want to look at who our forefathers are. We try to talk to brothers and sisters about the Bible, and they tell us, yeah, that happened, but what does it have to do with today? It has everything to do with today. Let's go back to Deuteronomy 28 right quick. I'm going to show you one more curse real quick before I move on. Give me verse 32.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28 and verse 32. Mm-hmm. Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, mm-hmm, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them all the day long.
So our sons and our daughters were sold into slavery and to other people, not just your so-called white man, but to the Arabs, Africans, and everybody else, the Chinese, whoever you can name. Go ahead.
And there shall be no might in thine hand.
And there what?
And there shall be no might in thine hand.
And there shall be no military might in thy hand. So no, you cannot take up arms against this country at this point in time, or any country at this point in time. Because it was prophesied there's a certain period of time when there's going to be war made, but this is not the time. This is a spiritual battle, a battle for the minds of the people. So either you're helping forward this truth and you're helping brothers wake up and get conscious to who they are and what they're supposed to be doing, or you're putting our people backwards like the so-called pastors are doing. You're doing one of the two. There's nobody stagnant just sitting in space not doing anything. Either you're progressing or digressing. So you have to understand there's no military might in our hands. So the thing we have to do is free the minds of the people. How? Through the scriptures. That's how we're going to free the minds of the people. Show them who they are. Show them what our forefathers did. Consider the days of 32. All right? Here's proof that you have to do these things in order to succeed in this society. Because once you see what your forefathers did and what they were capable of and how they did it, guess what? You duplicate the same thing. I teach my child. She teaches her child. He teaches his child. Whatever the case may be. That's how you do it. Go ahead.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 32 and verse 7. Remember the days of old.
Remember the days of old. Go ahead.
Consider the years of many generations. Mm-hmm. Ask thy father, and he shall show thee. Thy elders, and they will tell thee.
You see that? So you have to reach out to the people who have the knowledge. We're going to bring out some stuff in this book called The Invisible War, right? Why is it called The Invisible War? Because they tried to hide it. They tried to hide this from our people. Why? Because they didn't want us to know who we are and how great we are. I'll sum it up in a minute and just go into some details inside of it. But it says, consider the days of old and many generations before you. Go and get the word of mouth from your elders. How do we get the word of mouth from my elders? From the Bible, because it's written. It's scribed. The pen is mightier than a sword. Because you could pick up arms for one day, but this Bible has lasted longer than any model of gun or tank or bomb or anything else. It's still here. And guess what? When those bombs drop, guess what's still going to be here? This word is going to be carried through us. All right? Anything else before I move on? All right, so before I get to it, just give me Psalm 137 right quick. Start at verse 1. All right, we got to understand it said, consider the days of old. Well, what happened to us in the days of old? Let's see.
The book of Psalm, chapter 137 and verse 1. By the rivers of Babylon, mm-hmm. there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion.
The rivers of Babylon. This country is Babylon the Great. What rivers? Any river in America where they sold us into slavery. Any river you can imagine here. Read that part again so they can understand what's being said.
By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion.
There we wept when we remembered our homeland. The whole point of us being put into captivity is so after a certain amount of time, we would look back, remember who we are, repent, and go do what God required of us. So we remember our homeland. Go ahead.
We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. Mm-hmm. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song.
When it says we hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof, that's talking about the willow tree. It's sunken down and sorrowful and so forth. All right. It resembles how we felt. All right. It says, for they that carried us away required of us a song. That's why you have at these different marches and presidential elections and so forth, they don't ask for Miley Cyrus to come sing the national anthem.
That's right.
They get Aretha Franklin. They get our people. The most powerful voices on earth. That's who they get to come sing. Go ahead.
And they that wasted us required of us mirth.
Laughter. Go ahead.
Saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion.
Why? Because we in captivity talking about rulership. Just like today. We in captivity right now talking about rulership. Talking about how we're going to be the ruling class and the other nations going to be the serving class. They laugh at that. Go ahead.
How shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land?
Here in America, go ahead.
If I forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget her cunning.
So we have to remember where we come from. Why? Because it's the only thing we have. If you don't remember where you come from, how can you ever really stand up for anything, right? How can you even have instructions on how to stand up? Because everything we're doing now was taught to us by the white man. They taught us to protest. Yeah, they taught us to protest. When you go look back with Malcolm X and so forth, and the way that it was supposed to be, opposed to the way that it actually happened, the so-called white man is the one who implemented the signs and the picketing and marching a certain way. They ushered us and told us which way to go, where to buy your signs from, what sign to hold, and so forth. They taught us how to protest. So guess what? You got to remember where you come from. Because if you remember where you come from, you know protesting, voting does nothing, right? You have to take action. Go ahead.
Verse 6. If I do not remember thee, mm-hmm. let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth.
Watch, you shouldn't say nothing at all. Go ahead.
If I prefer not Jerusalem above my chief joy.
You prefer Babylon and the things that Babylon offers above your homeland and what came with that, which is our freedom, which is our liberty. Something's wrong with you. That means you love your oppressor so much beyond assimilation. He's your idol. You love him so much that he's your idol now. You want to follow everything he has set up for you. And guess what? State Senator, you one of them. Go ahead.
Verse 7. Remember, O Lord, the children of Edom mm-hmm. in the day of Jerusalem, who said, raise it, even to the foundation thereof.
So the scriptures say, remember Edom, that same nation. Edom is a so-called white man, if you didn't know. It says what?
Remember, O Lord, the mm-hmm. children of Edom in the
children of Edom, meaning the generations after him. Go ahead.
In the day of Jerusalem, mm-hmm. who said, raise it, even to the foundation thereof.
Right. Those people that cried out for the destruction of the Israelites, which is the residual effects of that is what you see in the communities. Drug addicts, gangs, fatherless homes. Right. Everything that you see in our communities is a residual effect of what they did to destroy us. If you don't know that or don't realize that, guess what? You're going to be in that same trap and going that same loop over and over again, contributing to what they set up for you. But that's what we're here to liberate your mind. Go ahead.
Verse 8. O daughter of Babylon,
uh-huh.
who art to be destroyed,
mm-hmm.
happy shall he be that rewarded thee as thou hast served us.
Meaning what? Destruction is coming to this place. Go ahead.
Happy shall he be that taketh and dasheth thy little ones against the stones.
When did this happen? When they were conquering our brothers and sisters here in what you call the Americas. Taking the little ones and dashing them against the stone. It's giving you the identity of the people who are going to be destroyed. So knowing that, why would you reach out to them for safety and for help and security? They can't help you. They don't want to help you.
Right.
Right. Your brothers want to help you. We the ones that's trying to tell you what you should be doing based on what the Bible. Everybody loved the Bible for years. Everybody loved the Bible. Oh, I love Jesus and so forth until the truth come out. When the truth come out of who your enemies are, who Christ's enemies were, what you're supposed to do, guess what? Now everybody hates the Bible. But all we're trying to do is give you information and show you that we know what we're talking about. We know who the enemy is, and you cannot reach out to them for help. Otherwise, guess what we're going to have? More shootings, more killings. The day after the cops got shot here in Dallas, guess what? Two more cops got shot that we know of. Is that the end of it? Probably not. Why? Because that's the way it was set up. This space is going to be destroyed. Anything else before I move on? But I'm about to go into some more stuff. I don't want to take up the whole time, so I'm going to keep going. All right, so before we move on into the scripture some more, go to page 18.
Yes, sir.
We're going to bring out some stuff in this book. This book, again, let me show them real quick. This is just one of many that this brother purchased and has me studying to teach his class. this is called The Invisible War. What is this talking about? This is going into the time period of 1817 through 1858. All right, through 1858. If you know any history during that time, what was happening? You had different wars that were spread out through what you call the Americas, right? The French, the Spanish, the American, the British, and so forth. We're all here fighting for different reasons on different sides. Well, with all the midst of all of that, guess what? Judah, as we know today, is the so-called blacks, the black American, and Reuben, our northern kingdom brothers, guess what we did? We linked up together, and we started to fight for our liberation, physically. And by the end of the war, which y'all know of as the Emancipation Proclamation, right, which happened in, 1863, that would not have happened had we not fought and showed that we have power. When you go into this book, it shows you that. It's called The Invisible War because they didn't want us taught this throughout history that, hey, these so-called blacks and these so-called Indians, as they call them, were more, well, less than us, but mightier than us. In this same book, it tells you, had it not been for them, that the so-called Americans would not have won the war. And they know that. But come on, let's read some of this right quick.
This book is called The Invisible War. This is page 18. The forced use of African people as the raw material for the animation of the U.S. capitalistic economic system mm-hmm. was no doubt a difficult endeavor, mm-hmm. adventure, and dangerous experiment, probably as complex as putting a man on the moon.
You see, read that, but I don't think they understood that. Read it again.
The forced use of African people.
The forced use of African people.
As the raw material for the animation of the U.S. capitalistic economic system.
Right, which we live in today. Go ahead.
Was no doubt a difficult endeavor.
That's why they had to reach out to your boy Willie Lynch to get some understanding on how to get this thing running right. Go ahead. Because when you read in the Willie Lynch letters, it tells you this is not just something that you're going to set up for just today. You can't just beat the hell out of them, kill them, and hang them and think you're going to have a business. You got to destroy them mentally, is what he told us. And then you can have generation after generation of slaves mentally. Go ahead.
Adventure and dangerous experiment, mm-hmm. probably as complex as putting a man on the moon.
Why? Why did they say dangerous? Because they were going against us, the same people. They knew who we were. And they know when it came to, you know, being physical, the scriptures say one people shall be stronger than the other. You best believe. You look in your sports, you know who the strongest people are. So it was dangerous. So if they physically couldn't overcome us, guess what? They would have lost. So they know mentally was something they had to do. That's why it was complex, because you can't destroy somebody who knows who he is. You got to destroy generations down the line. That's complex. They say putting a rocket ship on the moon is just as complex, and that's supposed to be called science. Go ahead.
It requires several obvious conditions.
All right.
Stage one. First, proclaiming to an isolated and therefore globally ignorant European population that the Africans were an uncivilized, subhuman people who could be treated, who could be trained to accept enslavement and to provide children who would do the same.
So basically what it's saying is they wanted to have all the other markets of the world see us as nothing but niggas and coons, is what it's saying. And that they have no self-control, and without us, they don't have a civilization. Go ahead.
Stage two. The separation and isolation of a group of individual Africans from their various cultures.
So, what is this? They know who you are. Read that again.
The separation. And isolation.
And isolation, meaning I'm going to separate the Northern Kingdom brothers from the tribe of Issachar, from the brothers in the tribe of Gad. And I'm going to separate Judah from Benjamin and from Levi. Go ahead.
Of a group of individual Africans.
They called us Africans. Remember, we're not African. So when they say groups of individual Africans, they're talking about slaves from different tribes that they got. Go ahead.
From their various cultures.
Go ahead.
And their various languages, mm-hmm. in such a manner that they would be unable for a sufficient amount of time to communicate with each other.
You see that? So they said for how long of a time?
In such a manner that they would be unable for a sufficient amount of time.
They knew eventually we would be able to communicate. We would be able to read in English, Spanish, dialogue with each other, Portuguese, whatever the language was, whatever captivity we were in. It said for a sufficient amount of time. How much is sufficient? Until they destroy it. That's what they mean by sufficient amount of time. When they're destroyed, they don't know they're the same people. They no longer look to each other for security. They no longer want to link up and unite. Okay, that's a sufficient amount of time. Then, if they want to talk amongst themselves, talk about basketball, Atlanta Housewives, the latest Jordans that came out, we'll let them talk. But while they talk about liberating and revolting, nah. They cannot have no communication. Isolate them. You are Hispanic, you are black, y'all hate each other. That's it. Go ahead.
Let me read this.
Yeah, go ahead.
The separation and isolation of a group of individual Africans from their various cultures and their various languages in such a manner that they would be unable for a sufficient amount of time to communicate with each other, mm-hmm. and would be obliged to adopt the oppressor's language.
They would be obliged to adopt the oppressor's language. That's why the black spoke English, the Spanish spoke Issachar spoke Spanish. Wherever you were, you spoke the language of your oppressor. They knew what they were doing. When you read the Psalms 83, it tells you that. But go ahead.
Even in communications with each other, mm-hmm. note the prisons of Elmina in Ghana and Isle de Gor in Senegal, mm-hmm. and the early pest and cabin houses in South Carolina.
Right. When you go to Ghana, guess what? Those are Israelites. Bishops and some of the officers, captains, and so forth took a trip to Ghana. Why? Because our people are over there. They separated us, isolated us. Go ahead.
Number three, the discovery of the conquest of such a land where such an experiment is chattel slavery, mm-hmm. might take place. Mm-hmm. The children of the candidates for slavery had to be taught at first that they had no history.
Read that again.
The children of the candidates for slavery had to be taught at first that they had no history.
Why do you think the Bible tells you to remember the days of old? Because they taught us we don't have history. This is what they taught you. So why do you think black men say, oh, I'm committed? Because the white man taught you you were committed. That's part of them teaching you have no history. Because when you start to do the research and you go back in time, you're going to have a conflict. When you try to reach out to these other Africans and so forth, you don't look like them. They don't like you. You have no. They come over. If a real comedic person, which is a Hamite, come over and set up a business, how many Jakes does he hire? Zero. But he'll charge you for them fake Jordans and polos. They don't like you because they're not your people. Go ahead.
The children of the candidates for slavery had, mm-hmm. to be taught at first that they had no history, mm-hmm. culture, or language.
Right. Well, we have all of this. The only way you find out what that is through the scriptures. Go ahead.
That as such, they were not fully human beings, and that they belonged to their oppressors.
That we belong to our people. Damn. When you go to these different countries, and they see Sergio Borgia, they love him. They follow him in the streets downtown marching, and almost got shot up because of it. Because they depend on their oppressors. Read that part again. That's fire.
That as such, they were not fully human beings, mm-hmm. and that they belonged to their oppressors. Mm-hmm. Can I say something real quick?
Yeah, go ahead.
That's the three-fifths of the man. That's the first thing that came to my mind. Yeah. America implemented this.
There you go.
From the get-go.
Yeah. They knew what they were doing. Again, when you go into this book, you find out the liberation. Abraham Lincoln. I'm going to touch that in a minute. I'm finished this. I'm going to touch him in a minute. Go ahead.
Number five. When they revolted against this nonsense, mm-hmm. they had to be convinced, as Condoleezza Rice and her president, George Bush, often implied when dealing with the Palestinians, that to resist is useless.
Right. So basically saying, nigga, you a slave and remain that way. To fight is useless. We have the power over you. So just give it up and do what we told you to do. Break the Sabbath, be a drunkard, a whoremonger, and so forth, and live your life the way we taught you, nigga. If not, guess what? We're going to put you to death. Go ahead.
That to resist is useless, and do what you are told, or die and go to hell for resisting.
There you go. Read on. Because that means they were preaching white Jesus, what that's telling you. Go ahead.
This involved the role of the black church.
The role of the what?
The black church.
Let me see. Who was leading the protest the other day when brothers got shot up and so forth? Brothers' cars got shot up, locked down in the city. Who was leading that protest? A pastor. Who? What is his name? He's the same pastor that's leading the one in the New Orleans, Baton Rouge today, right?
Yeah.
The same pastor. Read that part again. Who had a role?
Do what you are told or die and go to hell for resisting. This involved the role of the black church.
This involved the role of the black church, which is still prevalent today. They teach you that you ain't nothing but a Gentile. There's no salvation for you unless you bow down to the white man and so forth. This is what they teach in the churches. And our people follow it.
Right, because you had the march. 99% was blacks. But then they was walking with Caesar Bolt. Does that make any sense?
No sense at all. It does make sense when you understand what they've done.
Right.
And what they implemented and what never changed. The only way you can change this is if you do what? Liberate your mind. Free your mind. Go ahead. Because you're going to be in bondage until Christ comes as far as paying taxes and so forth. Go ahead.
Hold on real quick. Read the part again.
Yeah.
Right above that where it says...
Condoleezza, you want that?
Yeah.
As Condoleezza Rice and her president George Bush often implied when dealing with the Palestinians, that to resist is useless, and do what you are told or die and go to hell for resisting.
The part above that, about them owning us, or we're less than not human.
Okay, got you.
Yeah.
This is number four. The children of the candidates for slavery had to be taught at first that they had no history, culture, or language, mm-hmm. that as such, they were not fully human beings, and that they belonged to their oppressors.
They belonged to their oppressors. When you read Zechariah 11, it says, whose possessors do what?
Slay them.
That bottom part, where it says, or dies.
Do what you are told or die and go to hell for resisting.
Whose possessors slay them.
Mm-hmm.
That's biblical prophecy. A history book is bearing witness to you. Our spirits bear witness with the spirit of the Bible that we're the children of God.
Right.
Man, when you go, this book, bro, look, I'm telling you, online, the scripture's written all throughout here. Why? Because this book is part of Bible prophecy. It's part of Bible prophecy. But guess what? If you don't read, because they say if you want to hide, this is one proverb about us. If you want to hide something from a nigga, put it in a book. There's plenty of books with the same information in it. But we got to pick it up and read so we can have an understanding of what really happened, why we're in the condition that we're in. Then that shows you how to deal with your brothers and sisters based on God's laws, obviously, but be able to relate that to real life. But if you don't know real life and you ain't studied your own history, how can you know? So for you comedic people, this ain't happened to the Egyptians. This didn't happen to the Canaanites. This happened to the Israelites. Prove it otherwise. Go ahead.
Number six, when they still resisted, they had to be killed or imprisoned.
Mm-hmm.
All records of successful revolts or wars were downplayed or ignored.
What happened?
All records of successful revolts.
So all records of successful revolts. So we will talk about some of the revolts, right? But we're not going to talk about the ones that were successful. But this book actually goes into some that are. But as far as what they put out in media and the movies and so forth, you best believe, like Nat Turner, right? We look at Nat Turner and we're like, oh, man, that was bad. He revolted. But what they show you in the end, they killed him.
Mm-hmm.
They put him to death. What about Negro Fort and all these other wars that we fought when we actually fought through it, lived through it, forced you to give us the Emancipation Proclamation? You gave it to us. And then after you gave it to us, you basically rape, robbed, and murdered us again, which we'll go into in a minute. But they don't talk about the successful ones. They want to talk about the ones where, look, this was your mighty man, Nat Turner, and he revolted, and guess what we did? We put him to death. That's what they're going to show you. But the ones that were successful, they either downplay or completely erase from history. Go ahead.
All records of successful revolts or wars were downplayed or ignored, with the attempt to obliterate such events from being recorded in history.
Why? Because when you see that and you know, as a unit, so Black Wall Street, was that not unity? Was that not, they had guns, but they were not going out to war against so-called white America. But what they did was they went to war on their pockets, right? On their economics, on their capitalist society. What happened to them? They got put to death. They got bombed. They do not want us to unite. They do not want us to come together, because they know when we do come together, what happens? We always get our freedom. That's why Zephaniah 2:1 is so read Zephaniah 2:1 right quick before we move on. This scripture is heavy, and it's overlooked, and we bring it out every week because of how heavy it is when you realize what the Most High is telling you to do. Go ahead. Brothers and sisters, it's that time. The bishop tells you, you're in the last days. However long those last days last, we don't know, but you're in the last days. How do we know? Because we know who we are. Go ahead.
The book of Zephaniah, chapter 2 and verse 1. Gather yourselves together.
Mm-hmm.
Yea, gather together, O nation not desired.
We just read to you, a part of their plan was to separate us from all markets of the world. Separate us from our brothers and our sisters. Right? Why? Isolate us. Why? Because when you're isolated and separated, you're weak. You're weak. But when you unite, especially under the umbrella of this Bible and who we are, guess what? Then you can become a nation that has some say-so and some power. Think about this. They tell us we're the minority. That's a way of them separating us. You're a minority black. You're a minority Hispanic. You're a minority this, that, and the other, right? The Bible said we outnumber the sands of the sea. When you look at, I'm just going to deal with just this side of it. I'm not even going to go to the scattered. I'm going to go to right here, North, Central, South America. If we outnumber the sands of the sea, meaning we outnumber our oppressors and so forth, why is it that they own everything? It's because we don't know our history. We don't know who we are. We think we're three-fifths of a man, right? We have no identity. So therefore, we keep serving the people that own us or possess us. But if we, the people of North, Central, South America, I'm talking about the oppressed people, the blacks, Hispanics, Native Americans, united under the understanding that we are the Israelites and we are one people, guess what we can do to this economy? We can take it over. Capitalism, knowledge of the head, it's ours. Think about the different resources that we have as a collective whole, not just one or two brothers. I'm talking about as a collective whole. You bring everything they set up comes to naught. But the only way that happens is if Zephaniah 2:1 comes to pass. Read that one more time.
The book of Zephaniah, chapter 2 and verse 1. Gather yourselves together, yea, gather together, O nation not desired.
O nation not desired. It tells us to gather ourselves because then we have power. We got to go to commercials.
Yeah.
All right, go ahead. Commercial.
Yeah, oh, we gotta go commercial. All
right, I got captivated, so forgive me.
I got a few more and I'll be done.
We're gonna go to a quick commercial break, and then we coming back. This is In the Scripts, from protests to shootings. Y'all are tuned in to In the Scripts.
I'll give him something while we waiting. Start at verse 1. I'll fly through it.
This is the book of Ezekiel, chapter 35 and verse 1.
Mm-hmm.
Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against Mount Seir.
Mount Seir is the homeland of the Edomites, the so-called white man. Go ahead.
And prophesy against it.
So the Most High prophesied against it. Go ahead.
And say unto it, Thus saith the Lord God,
mm-hmm.
Behold, O Mount Seir, I am against thee.
The Most High God is against Mount Seir and his people. Go ahead.
And I will stretch out mine hand against thee. And I will make thee most desolate.
Mm-hmm. So he's going to make it most desolate. Go ahead.
I will lay thy cities waste, and thou shalt be desolate, and thou shalt know that I am the Lord.
So this is future prophecy, what's going to happen. Go ahead.
Because thou hast had a perpetual hatred,
mm-hmm.
and hast shed the blood of the children of Israel by the force of the sword in the time of their calamity.
See that? So this is what they did. They had a perpetual hatred against us. And they show no remorse to us. They continue putting us to death. Go ahead.
In the time that their iniquity had an end.
The time my iniquity had an end is what you call Emancipation Proclamation, right? Ever since that time, guess what? Nothing changed. Even then, we were supposed to be free, but we still slaves. Go ahead.
Therefore, as I live, saith the Lord God,
uh-huh.
I will prepare thee unto blood, and blood shall pursue thee.
And blood shall pursue thee. These people that y'all want to take arms against, don't worry about it. The Most High God has a plan. I'll bring it right up. Most High God has a plan. And his plan is going to come, just like he said, I'm going to put you in the slavery on slave ships. It came to pass. When he said he's going to bring judgment upon them, it's going to happen. We don't have to pick up arms. We don't have to pick up guns and weapons for this to happen. Go to chapter 36, 22.
This is the book of Ezekiel, chapter 36 and verse 22.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore say unto the house of Israel, Thus saith the Lord God, I do not this for your sake.
So he's not doing it. He's not bringing us up into deliverance and putting people to death for our sake. Go ahead.
O house of Israel, but for mine holy name's sake.
Right, because he spoke it, it has to happen. For his holy name's sake. Go ahead.
Which ye have profaned among the heathen, whither ye went.
Uh-huh.
And I will sanctify my great name, which was profane among the heathen, mm-hmm. which ye have profaned in the midst of them. Mm-hmm. And the heathen shall know that I am the Lord, saith the Lord God, uh-huh. when I shall be sanctified in you before their eyes.
When he shall be sanctified in us before their eyes. Going back to Deuteronomy. I guess I'll get that scripture. Deuteronomy 4. It's my last one I've done. Man. It's going to be a time when the end comes. But if you ain't pushing this truth to the four corners of the earth, you just sitting back waiting and watching, you're part of the problem.
What verse you want, sir?
5.
This is the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 4, and verse 5. Behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments, mm-hmm. even as the Lord my God commanded me, that ye should do so in the land whither ye go to possess it.
In this country where we are right now, we're supposed to keep the law, statutes, commandments. Why?
Keep therefore and do them, uh-huh. for this is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations.
That's why when you go ahead, my bad.
Which shall hear all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people.
By us keeping the commandments, the other nations look at us and say, this is a wise and understanding people, wise nation. That's why he said, when I shall be sanctified in you before their eyes, because it says the kingdom of heaven is within you. So guess what? God is within you when you keep the commandments. And they're going to see it before their eyes. It's not going to be some dream they had. They're going to see it right before their eyes. These Negroes know who they are, and they're taking over. Nothing we can do about it. Go ahead, bro.
You good?
Nah. Yeah.
Officer, you had something?
No, go ahead, sir. I'm following you.
So until officer gets back, cause he ain't been in for a minute, man. So that brother can go until he's blue in the face, man. But I do want to touch a couple of things that I saw on Facebook and all these different social media outlets, things like that. Justice and peace. Black man, Hispanic man, I need you to understand: there will be no justice, there will be no peace until Christ returns.
Right.
That's just it. That's just it. I'ma prove it. Isaiah. And then, no, give me that in Isaiah 30 in verse 8. I'ma read this one. I'm gonna also get back to it.
This is the book of Isaiah, chapter 30 and verse 8. Now go, write it before them in a table, and note it in a book, that it may be for the time to come forever and ever.
So the book is the Bible, come on.
Verse 9. That this is a rebellious people.
That the Israelites, the so-called blacks, Hispanics, and Native Americans, you are a rebellious people. That's what the Bible says. Come on.
Lying children. Children that will not hear the law of the Lord.
Because we give you the solutions, but you reject that and say, no, we got to march some more. Hmm. We just got to hit our knees and pray some more. Come on.
Which say to the seers, see not.
Which say to the Israelites, those that are going out and at the 4th of July and at these different rallies and stuff, we're giving you the solutions, but you say, no, we don't want to hear that. Come on.
And to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things, speak unto us smooth things, prophesy deceits.
Prophesy lies. Yeah, we're going to get justice. Yeah, we're going to get peace.
How?
Exactly, but you don't tell them how.
Yeah.
Okay, Pastor, you say we're gonna get justice, we're gonna get peace. Okay, how?
Right.
You say we just gotta pray, and then what?
Right.
Then what? What's the solution after that? Come on.
Coonism.
Verse 11. Get you out of the way, turn aside out of the path, cause the Holy One of Israel to cease from before us. Wherefore, thus saith the Holy One of Israel.
Hold on. Meaning what? Read that last part again. Can't skip by that Deacon Yahushua butter, man. Get that right quick.
Verse 11. Yeah. Get you out of the way.
Uh-huh.
Turn aside out of the path.
Uh-huh.
Cause the Holy One of Israel to cease from before us.
Cause the Holy One of Israel to cease before us. Meaning what? Because they had Cedric Bozier out there, and they want that, like he was saying. They want those smooth words. They want that type of feeling. But when you say Christ is a black man from the tribe of Judah who tells you to repent from your sins, right? Quit following behind your enemies. Quit trying to assimilate with your enemies. They say, I don't want that Jesus. Give me the one with the white man with the beard and the cross that walking down the street. I'll follow
right,
him instead.
Right. The one was at the front of the pack.
Right.
That was leading the charge.
Yeah.
Yeah. The one that says I can go home and be a homosexual.
Yeah.
The one that says I can go home and still be in the midst of fornication, adultery. Give me that one.
Right. That's it. All right, the brother made a comment earlier about taking up arms. The officer went into. I'm just touch that real quick, and I'm gonna finish with just a couple of scriptures, and I'm gonna pass the mic. All right, I don't want to take up this whole next hour. So, get Baruch 3:8 right quick. Get Baruch 3:8. I will drop that. That's too much. A whole lot of information in that book, brothers. Y'all just gotta go read. I can sit here and read the book to you, but it'll help you if you read yourself. All right, The Invisible War. Get that book. Go ahead.
This is the book of Baruch, chapter 3:8.
All right. So even if you got guns, go ahead.
Behold, we are yet this day in our captivity.
Because when I bought that gun, I had to get a receipt for it and taxes I had to pay on it. Why?
Behold, we are yet this day in our captivity.
Uh-huh.
Where thou hast scattered us for a reproach and a curse.
Right. He scattered us through cargo slave ships. Go ahead.
And to be subject to payments.
And to what?
And to be subject to payments.
We are subject to, if every brother in this room decided we're going to get arms, we're going to get brothers to follow us. Malcolm X did it. They had guns. We still in captivity. We still pay taxes.
Right.
Nothing has changed. That's not what frees you. Go to John 8:32. That's not freedom. Taking up arms is not freedom. He read to you earlier for the brothers on the radio show. We read earlier that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to doing what? Pulling down the strongholds of our mind. Again, mind liberation, free in your mind. Go ahead.
The book of John, chapter 8:32.
Uh-huh.
And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
The truth is what makes you free. The truth of who you are, where you come from, what's required of you, how to live, how to treat your brothers, your sisters, how to raise your kids. These things are the things that's going to set you free. Because now we're not looking to false resources, or as a brother was going to in the last scripture, we're not looking to these false pastors and so forth who were set up by the white man to give us our instructions on life. We have our instructions on life. It says the truth is what?
And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
All right, get page 58 in that book and just read the highlighted part, and we'll go right back to the Bible. I'm just read this one part out of it and go right back to the Bible. Read that.
This is the African-American insurgency on page 58. The Africans may have represented themselves to the First Nations as persons ultimately wanting to be free to return to their homelands in Africa.
Right, so this is the Israelites saying that we want to go back to our homeland is not Africa. Our homeland is Jerusalem. We fled to Africa because of the persecution on our true homeland. So at that time, that's what we called our homeland. So we wanted to go back to Ghana or wherever else we were at the time, because that's where we can keep our laws and our statutes, and we can keep our ceremonial days and so forth. Go ahead.
The religious beliefs of many of these African Americans indicate that the worst thing that could happen to them after death was their spirit not to find its way home to their families.
Right. So they were thinking even on a spiritual level, meaning what? That we were so destroyed that even when we die, our spirit can't make it back to a place of rest. We wouldn't have no place of rest here. Even when you die was their worry. But they understood that, no, we don't want to be free under our enemies. We want to be free in our own homeland. We want our own. Get Hebrews 11:14. We do not want to be here dwelling with these Edomites who torture us, who kill our wives, sell our sons and our daughters into slavery, hang us on trees, whip our backs. Why the hell do I want to live with them? So they always say, oh, you nigga, go back to your country where you come from. Well, guess what, Mr. White Man? Did you not realize you took over the whole world? That you own almost everything except for Japan, maybe? In China? Because Russia, guess what? The Russian is a form of a white man. Europe is a form of a white man. Who owns these places? The white man. So even if we go to Africa, guess who's really running Africa? It ain't our people. Even if it's, say it's a dark nation of people in Africa running a particular part of that country. Is that our people? Are we going to be liberated? Nah. You're still going to be treated like dirt. Go ahead.
This is the book of Hebrews, chapter 11:14.
Uh-huh.
For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country.
They seek a country. We don't want to be here in America, but we have to be. Why? Because we held captive until the day of deliverance come. Go ahead.
And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out.
Had they been mindful, like our forefathers were, as we just read about, had they been mindful of that country. Go ahead.
They might have had opportunity to have returned.
Right. Meaning what? They had an opportunity to repent and thence be redeemed. But if you don't repent, you don't know where you come from, there's no redemption coming. The redemption comes when the one-third repents. Go ahead.
But now they desire a better country, that is an heavenly, wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God.
They desire a better country, which is heavenly, meaning what? It's righteous. the rape, rob, murder, and all sorts of crime that you see now won't be in the kingdom, because judgment will come immediately. But because, for the most part, everybody has in their heart that they want to keep the law, statutes, commandments, because they understand the bondage we came out of. They understand who we were under for centuries. They understand, now, I'm talking about the 130 and the 144, we understand where we come from and what's required of us. So we don't want to be in your country, but we physically have to be. Why? Because we can't return to our homeland until Christ come. Go ahead.
Wherefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God.
He's not ashamed to be called our God. If I had to be the God of the so-called Jews in our land today, I would be ashamed. They kidnap babies and cook them up in hamburger meat. They do all types of manner of wickedness. I would be ashamed to be their God. But when you talk about the greatest people on the planet Earth, I'm not ashamed to be their God. Because they, according to Abraham, they was going to be the ones that keep my law, statutes, and commandments. It says in Isaiah 45:17, Israel shall be, I'm finna butcher it. It should never be ashamed. Mm-hmm. Basically, we should never be ashamed. And the Most High is not going to be ashamed of us. Go ahead.
For he hath prepared for them a city.
He prepared for us a kingdom is what it's talking about. I'm gonna touch two more scriptures. I'm going to give you a couple dates right quick. 1865. KKK was established in 1865. We just told you about the wars in this book that were fought. They call it the Seminole Wars, but it was really the Israelite wars with the Northern and Southern Kingdom fighting against the oppressors. All right, so in 1817 to 1858, wars were fought and won, lost, and so forth. They told you how they suppressed some of them, downplayed some of them, and just completely ignored some of them, right? Within that time, we won some wars. Negro Fort is what the book is really going into. So from the time of 1858 to 1865 is not a long time. Guess who was formed when we were liberated? Emancipation Proclamation happened in 1863. So we're talking 2 years after the Emancipation Proclamation, you had the KKK form. What else happened in 1865? 1865, Abraham Lincoln was assassinated. The reason why he was assassinated, 1865, the Freedmen Bank was established. The Freedmen's Bureau was established. What was that? That was an establishment for the so-called blacks to be able to go get information, learn how to, according to them, conduct ourselves in their society, learn their stocks and so forth, whatever. Liberate ourselves. The liberation of the black man, right? Physically. Guess what happened? Abraham Lincoln was put to death. Abraham Lincoln was put to death. Andrew Johnson came in after him, took his place, vetoed the bill for the Freedmen's Bureau and the Freedmen's Bank, shut it down, and then what happens? Economic failure for us. They stole over $2 million from us that we invested in this bank and so forth. And they said it was corruption at the top or whatever. No, you just stole our money. That is corruption. Yeah, you stole our money. And put us right back into the same economic situation we were in. Later on down the line, we had what? Jim Crow laws and so forth. So they never intended for us to be free.
Right.
And as long as we're here paying taxes, we will never be free. You have to free your mind. Give me Jeremiah 22 and 13.
The book of Jeremiah, chapter 22 and verse 13. Woe unto him that buildeth his house by unrighteousness, mm-hmm. and his chambers by wrong, that useth his neighbor's service without wages, and giveth him not for his work.
One more time.
Woe unto him that buildeth his house by unrighteousness.
The scripture say, woe unto him that buildeth his house by unrighteousness. Now, this was talking about an Israelite brother at the time, but in today's time, who built their houses with unrighteousness or by unrighteousness? The so-called white man. How did he do that? Let me see. There's people on this land. I come over on ships. I kill these people. And not only do I kill them, but I take the rest of them, put them in captive, and say, build me a house, build me a plantation that you're going to work on for me. That's building your house by unrighteousness. Go ahead.
And his chambers by wrong,
uh-huh.
that useth his neighbor's service without wages.
And now on top of that, I'm not going to pay you for your services because you're a slave, nigga. In their mind, that's how they saw us. And so he did what? Read that last part again.
That useth his neighbor's service.
Plow my fields, pick my cotton, get my sugar cane. Any other area of slavery you could think of, this is what they did to us without wages. Go ahead.
Without wages. And giveth him not for his work.
Uh-huh.
That saith, I will build me a wide house and large chambers.
Mm, that's your big old plantation you see down here in the south. Go ahead.
And cutteth him out windows.
Mm-hmm.
And it is sealed with cedar, mm-hmm. and painted with vermilion.
That's why you see those big old beams basically in the front of their houses with them big old windows and so forth. Right? Why? Because off the backs of the Israelites, they would get their wealth. They would establish what you see before you, Six Flags, the baseball stadium. You got Cowboy Stadium right next to us. And who funds the Cowboy Stadium? The slaves on the field. The people in the box got billions of dollars. Mm-hmm. The athlete on the field got a broken bone and $1 million. That $1 million only going to last for so long because you might play 4 years. You might have a long career, as they call it, 13-year career like Ray Lewis. And if you don't invest your money, guess what? In another 5 to 10 years, you're going to be broke.
Right.
Because that's not wealth. That's just you rich for the moment, but that's not wealth.
Broke with a concussion.
Broke with a concussion. You might not even remember who you are the next day you wake up.
Right.
Walk out into the middle of the street, get hit by a bus.
Right.
That is slavery at its best. It's the same exact thing that was established back then. But the Most High said, woe unto him that do that to my people. So when you see these uprisings and so forth, you got to understand where that's coming from. It's biblical prophecy.
Shalom, Israel. I'm Elder Nathaniel, Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to Join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC to stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this Join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.